And it's the flag of Uganda draped across the shoulders of Stephen Kiprotich. He is the Olympic champion.
For 7 years, the questions had been asked countless times. Could debt-ridden Britain afford this? Did a nation of doubters have the conviction to pull this off? Could the athletes deliver? Now the questions had to stop. There was time only to take a deep breath and let London stir.
Earth has not anything to show more fair. Dull would he be of soul who could pass by a sight so touching in its majesty. This city now doth like a garment wear the beauty of the morning. Silent, bare, ships, towers, domes, theatres and temples lie open under the fields and to the sky, all bright and glittering in the smokeless air.
With that, the action began, with something of a whisper, the sigh of a hope dashed.
Mark Cavendish's gold medal chances are slipping away here.
It just seems like most teams, they're happy not to win as long as we don't win. That's the story of our life.
When the first medal came, it was celebrated. Relief at being off the mark. There was a first British medal in men's team gymnastics for 100 years. And a team on a different kind of horse won silver. Even so, there was a slight sense of anticlimax. The bronze for Rebecca Adlington was okay.
It was hard, it was so hard.
But 4 days had gone by. Nobody dared suggest that Team GB were choking. But when would somebody clear their throat and let out a roar? Where was the gold? It came on the fifth day. Rowing, ever reliable rowing, rowed to the rescue.
It's an exceptional start now from Helen Glover and Heather Stanning. They are just storming away. And look at that, it is simply stunning. They move away, and they move away with some power and grace. They are making history here at Eton Dorney. Helen Glover and Heather Stanning, we stand up and we salute you.
The pair that rowed to gold, and about to hit the road out of Hampton Court, Britain's favourite pair of sideburns, as worn by the first Briton ever to win the Tour de France, just days before the time trial here.
Man that certainly hasn't lost any fluidity at all is Bradley Wiggins. Look at this. He is actually poetry in motion. 6 medals to his credit in the Olympics, and it's looking like it's going to be gold today. Bradley Wiggins is the Olympic champion.
To be honest, it had to be gold today or nothing, you know. I mean, what's the point in having 7 medals if they're not the right colour, you know? And but the main one is that it's number four, so I've got to carry on to Rio now and go for number five.
Already making plans for the future, but for the moment, Bradley deserved a break. he set off to celebrate with a night on the tiles without his bike. Also smashed the British record for the men's 200 metres breaststroke.
It's a fantastic silver medal for Great Britain, and Michael Jameson, what a brilliant swim that was.
For the 40-year-old Greg Searle, bronze in the eight. A silver for Gemma Gibbons, and a message to her mum. What had started slowly was gathering pace. The medal rush, one after the other, two in the same event.
Valiant start through the finish line, and that is the fastest time we've seen. Don't just get one, we get two medals.
The last of this rapid-fire medal burst, Peter Wilson, 6'6" tall and coached by Sheikh Ahmed Al Maktoum, a farmer's son from Dorset, coached by a member of Dubai's ruling family.
And he does it! Peter Wilson has done it!
Four medals in the space of 47 minutes. Back at the lake, there was about to be one of the finishers of the games.
Great Britain get the silver!
Now, the mighty Sir Steve Redgrave had been passed by Bradley Wiggins as Britain's most decorated Olympian. Another cyclist on the other side of town was about to try to equal Sir Steve as the winner of the most gold medals. To the velodrome, palace of the king, or at least the knight of cycling.
Here comes the horse, lining up for the run to the line of the crowd, going absolutely mad. Gold medal for Great Britain. That is the fifth gold medal won in the Olympics by Sir Chris Hoy.
What about the queen of the track? Victoria Pendleton, along with Jess Varnish, disqualified in the women's team sprint. And there was trouble for the first Sea Lord. Ben Ainslie wasn't dominating in the Finn class, and he was made by his rival to take a penalty turn at just the wrong moment, or the right moment to wind him up.
You know, he made a big mistake because I'm angry, and he didn't want to make me angry.
The Olympic Stadium was about to reopen for business. Early in the morning, the heptathlete stepped out to be greeted by this.
Jessica Ennis has got the potential to set this stadium alight. Her Olympic adventure starts here. She is a one-woman athletics team, and this is one of her favourite events. Sure. Jess got away to a good start. Jessica Ennis has been closed down by Sarah Ent of Belgium, but now she's beginning to pull away on the inside. Jess Salinka's going well, and this is a tremendous run by Jessica Ennis. Oh my goodness! The fastest time ever by a heptathlete. The power of the crowd carried Jess Ennis.
The first day of athletics, the last day of judo for Karina Bryant, and a bronze medal. And on the theme of last days, was this the last chapter in the silver-tinted career of Catherine Granger? At the age of 36, one last chance for a gold medal.
Ladies and gentlemen, what we are seeing right now is that dreams do come true. At long, long last, Catherine Granger is the Olympic champion.
Where's the weight?
Gold at last for Catherine Granger. And for the men on this Women's Day at the Games, a pair of bronzes for George Nash and Will Satch, who came together only a few months ago. And then a Northern Irishman. And the danger of being on your own is that there's nobody there to say, Alan Campbell, don't push it too far. If this was Women's Day, as in grown-up women, It was also a girls' night out. Into the pool went 15-year-old Katie Ledecky of the United States, showing no respect for her elders, including the reigning Olympic champion, Rebecca Adlington.
I think the pressure and everything, just the expectation, everything going into this meet has been a little bit of a battle, but I gave it my absolute all, and I'm sorry that I didn't get the gold for everyone that was expecting me to.
In the velodrome, in the slightly wacky world of the Keirin, Victoria Pendleton took care this time, and then reached for the turbocharger.
Oh! Victoria Pendleton takes the gold medal!
I can't believe it. Thank you so much. I mean, to everyone that's helped me get here, the crowd has been fantastic.
In the men's team pursuit, Ed Clancy, Geraint Thomas, Stephen Burke and Peter Kenyuk had broken the world record on their way to the final. They now faced their old rivals, the Australians. The new world record wasn't safe.
Half a lap to go for the British team. The world record is 3:52.499. The gold medal is Great Britain's. Here they come up to the line. Oh, look at the time. It's a new world record. And Great Britain have won the gold medal.
Saturday, August the 4th, the middle Saturday, day 8 of the Games. Compressing medals into concentrated bursts was to remain the fashion, starting at the lake on this special day. The emotion would flow, but not here. Four steely men in their boat of Kevlar and carbon fibre with Milmex honeycombs.
We have done it! We have done it! And we have done it in style! Great Britain, the Olympic champions!
And in the very next race...
So Sophie Hosking and Catherine Copeland now just rowing up to the line. They are the Olympic champions! An incredible, incredible skull!
Two golds in two races. Greedy almost. Almost. But then it came apart. And suddenly we had to know about the small print of rowing, the 100-metre rule that allowed for a restart.
And on the line now, Denmark just sneaking ahead of Great Britain.
We gave everything. We tried everything. We wanted to win so badly. Sorry to everybody we've let down.
You let nobody down.
Reliable rowing on the Lake of Tears. Four golds, two silvers, three bronzes. No wonder the water turned a little salty. The work was not yet done at the velodrome. Here, too, a fourth gold was about to be won.
They are on fire! Danny Keane, Laura Trott and Jana Rousel are the Olympic champions.
Fell, and all eyes turned to the Olympic Stadium and the last installment of a seven-part drama.
This could be gold. If you cheer loudly enough, get to ground, it's not hitting you. It doesn't matter that somebody's overtaken her. She's given us a magnificent seven events already. And here goes Jess. Going to be the Olympic champion. Everybody is on their feet. The pride of Sheffield, the pride of Great Britain. Jessica Ennis is the Olympic champion.
All this hard work and the disappointment of Beijing, and everyone just supported me so much. I'm so happy.
The stadium had barely settled when an injury-plagued 25-year-old from Bletchley, Milton Keynes, set off down the runway.
And it's Ben! Can you believe what is happening in this stadium at the moment? 8 metres and 31! Olympic long jump champion Greg Rutherford.
And barely had the crowd finished celebrating that when a 29-year-old from Mogadishu, Somalia, who came to Britain at the age of 8, set off on 25 laps of the track.
So the 10,000-metre final underway.
That's his first move, real serious move, and there's been a response this time from Bekele. Mo Farah hits the front. A lap to go, the bell rings. Is it tolling for a gold medal for Great Britain? Will Farah have enough?
My daughter just like really emotional, she's just coming out running to me, and I was just like, wow.
Three gold medals in 45 minutes. Who could follow that? One man could, and he will have his moment. But elsewhere, a sense that such a day could not be bettered. A bronze for Ed Clancy in the Omnium. Christine Uruhugu so close in the 400 metres.
A sterling, sterling effort to get the silver.
A silver for Ian Percy and Andrew Simpson in the star class. Not much drama on this day after. In the gymnastics, suddenly there was, on the pommel horse. First Max Whitlock, and then, last to go, Lewis Smith.
That is superb. For my money, that's worth a gold medal.
It's a tie because the execution score was slightly lower than Berkey's. Berkey will take gold.
Down at the sailing, it had been fraught for Ben Ainslie, but he'd won gold, making it four golds and one silver at five games. What was the Admiral's mood now?
You are the greatest Olympic sailor in history.
Yeah.
Not such a quiet day after all. From Weymouth to Wimbledon, it was about to go wild. A sometimes grumpy Scot from Dunblane, never really sure about his popularity, discovered he was a darling of the nation. Andy Murray had beaten Novak Djokovic. Now he faced the player who defeated him in the Wimbledon final, the great Roger Federer.
Since he pulled on that Team GB shirt, he's been like a man possessed this week.
It's a golden triumph for Andy Murray.
It's number one for me, biggest win of my life. And this week's been incredible. Had a lot of fun. Support's been amazing.
Immediately into the mixed doubles final with Laura Robson, silver. Jason Kenny had been picked ahead of Sir Chris Hoy for the men's sprint. If the rider from Farnworth in Bolton was feeling the pressure of being selected ahead of the Scotsman, it didn't show.
Kenny's got the head of the race, Harcourt gave him up, take it! Kenny is the Olympic sprint champion! He wins the gold medal and he won it in style!
The battle I had just to get here, you know, with Chris, knowing that you've got someone on the sideline that kind of definitely wouldn't give that second sprint away, so I was like, oh, I better not mess this one up, mate.
Beth Tweddle had led the revival in British gymnastics, three times world champion, but never an Olympic medalist. She'd kept going for this, one last go, and a bronze medal. Greenwich Park, handsome home for horses and riders. The show jumping team were little fancied. The last time Britain had won a medal in this event was 1952. But here, just a few strides from the Greenwich Prime Meridian, everything was on the line.
Just the double in the last jump. Team gold. Come on!
Now the last. Down to Tower Bridge for goals.
This could be the first goal for the year since 1952, and Britain have got gold!
It means, I mean, absolutely everything to win this, especially for our country, for show jumping, you know. For me, personally, it's everything.
The moment came for an abdication. It was time for the King and Queen of Cycling to say their Olympic farewell. Queen Victoria left with a silver, but with such a sense of relief.
Ever thought you'd disappoint us?
It's all over. You've been incredible, you've been incredible.
The King left with a leap into the record books.
Shoulder to shoulder now, as they come up the crown of the bend, and there they're lining up for the run for the line. Who's going to get it? Greg Toy gets the gold medal! That's his sixth gold medal! He becomes the greatest British Olympian!
I'm in shock, you know. You try and compose yourself and try to be able to take it all in, but this is just surreal. This is what I always wanted. You know, I wanted to win gold in front of my home crowd.
And who might fill the power vacuum? An all-rounder of the Omnium.
Remember, she's got to finish three places ahead of Hammer in the time trial. Gold medal is going to go to Lorna Trott.
In track cycling, there were 10 gold medals available. Britain won 7 of them. Such a tally was not possible on or near the athletics track, but this was a leap of faith by Robbie Grabars, taking Team GB's medal tally beyond the 47 won at the Beijing Games. The tally included a windsurfer skimming for silver over the waves, Nick Dempsey dancing on the sea, and horses dancing just behind the Naval College, where once they taught how to rule the waves.
They are a fabulous team. They've won Britain's first ever gold in dressage.
A triathlon. Three sports, one after the other. Two brothers, one after the other. The Brownleys, Jonathan the Junior, third behind Alistair.
This is effectively a lap of honour. Alistair Brownlee is the Olympic triathlon champion. And there will be both of the brilliant Brownlee brothers on the Olympic podium as Jonathan comes home for bronze.
Now this may be the contrast of the games. First that dressage again, the individual competition now, outdoors, delicate, exquisite.
I don't know how we've done it, but we've done it and now got two Olympic gold medals, so unbelievable.
And then this, indoors, volcanic, violent. Women's boxing was new to the Olympics, but Nicola Adams looked as if she was completely and utterly at home in the bedlam.
Absolutely blazing. Nicola Adams has just made history.
It's a dream come true for me. I've been dreaming about this since I was 12 years old, and the moment's finally come here, and you know, I've got my gold medal for Great Britain. Got another one on the board.
Fast hands and the fast feet of Jay Jones from Flint in the fight game of taekwondo.
It still doesn't feel real, it feels crazy. I've dreamt about it for ages, and then it's here, it's amazing. And the crowd has just been amazing.
It was less full on the next day, sailing to silver in the 470 class. Saskia Clark and Hannah Mills, Luke Patience and Stuart Bithell. A hockey medal, the first for 20 years. And a bronze for Lutalo Muhammad in taekwondo. Was that it? Way back, there had been anxiety about the first gold. Was there time for a last one? A last batch? A late whirl of arms?
It is gold for Ed McKeever! And the quiet man lets out a roar!
And the bronze for Liam Heath and John Schofield. In the world of Falling Beautifully, Tom Daly had been struggling a bit. These had been difficult times, losing his dad, Rob, to cancer last year. And here, not quite at his best. Until now. This was a bronze celebrated as if it were pure gold. In another flurry of arms, late medals came. A bronze had already come to middleweight Anthony Ogogo.
Let's keep smiling.
And now, bantamweight Luke Campbell was in the gold final.
Keep smiling.
Luke Campbell has done it again.
And keep laughing.
There was a silver for Fred Evans.
Keep punching.
And one rousing boxing finale.
Anthony Joshua is the Olympic super heavyweight champion.
The boxer who wouldn't give up and the modern pentathlete who didn't give up. Samantha Murray, silver.
Let's keep smiling.
Back to the Olympic Stadium for one last night of athletics.
Let's be happy.
Mo Farah had helped turn the second Saturday of the Games into a night to remember. What could he do now on the third and last Saturday?
The crowd are on their feet. They're trying to roar him home.
Saturday nights were Mo nights.
He's got to find something extra.
And keep laughing.
He's got to kick on. Farah is going to make it 2 gold medals for Great Britain. Beautiful.
Let's keep smiling.
The question had been asked, could Team GB deliver? They had delivered beyond expectation, out of this world.
Ho, 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 ho.
Early in the morning of the second Monday of the Games, a roving laboratory called Curiosity landed on Mars. Had Curiosity got the better of Curiosity, and had it pointed a camera back into space in the direction of home, it might have detected a surge of energy, signs of life on Earth. That would be the world going wild. How different from the sound a little earlier, when in the silence of space, you could hear a pin drop. Before the age of Usain Bolt, it was feared the 100 meters was turning into a chemical alley. Olympic lanes of suspicious speed. But Bolt in Beijing had made it pure theatre, and now he was top billing in London. This is the race that makes the world hold its breath. Not a long breath, just the time it takes for this long stretch of Jamaica to become a legend. But danger lurked. Johan Blake, his training partner, who had beaten him twice at the Jamaican trials. Also from Jamaica, Asafa Powell, and from across the Caribbean Sea, Richard Thompson of Trinidad and Tobago, and Chirandi Martina of Curaçao. And three Americans, Ryan Bailey, Tyson Gay, and Justin Gatlin, once banned for 4 years on a doping rap. The 100 meters, this had always been America's race. And they wanted it back. 80,000 drew their breath. And you could hear a pin drop on Mars.
Set. by Chris Bolt. You say Paul! He's pulling away! He's going to win the gold! And he's still the king of 100! The champion becomes a legend!
My coach said, stop worrying about the start. The best part of your race is at the end.
Once, from London, Britain had ruled Jamaica. Now, 50 years after independence, Jamaica ruled London.
Gold medalist and Olympic champion representing Jamaica, Usain Bolt!
The fastest man in the world.
Four days later, Bolt was back, and Blake was back, with a third Jamaican, Warren Weir, the 200. Bolt's favourite race.
Set.
Look at Bolt go! It's a 3 metre lead as they come into the home straight. Here comes Blake though, running him down, but he's not going to catch him. Bolt's going to do it again. 1932, gold all the way. Blake takes the silver. Warren Weir has got the bronze. A Jamaican clean sweep. You cannot argue that he has no equal. He is just incomparable in the world of sprinting. The only man ever to have defended the Olympic 200-metre title.
This is what I wanted, and I got it. I'm really dedicated to my work, and I know what London meant to me, and I came here and I gave it my all, I gave it my best, and I'm proud of myself.
For every Jamaican man, there is a Jamaican woman. There was a 100 metres title to defend here too.
Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce really blasted it. 10.75 seconds.
If Jamaica was leading the way, there was a response across the Caribbean. Here was Grenada's turn in a longer sprint.
Gerardi James is going to take Olympic gold, his nation's first ever.
The Dominican Republic.
Sanchez takes the gold medal.
The Bahamas.
The Bahamas are challenging the United States champions for the very first time.
That's how we put it down, gold.
The largest island in the Caribbean, Cuba. Cuba is big, but compared with America, still a speck. All these islands, flea bites on the flanks of the giant. And how would the giant react? Out came the champ, the greatest swimmer of all time at his fourth and last games. 6 golds in Athens, 8 in Beijing, going for 7 in London. This would show the world America wasn't spent yet, wouldn't it?
Phelps looks in trouble here. Is he going to lose the 400 to this guy leading? And he's leading by miles. Ryan Lochte wins the 400 medley. And look at that. Michael Phelps is fourth.
Not in the first final. Another swimmer was having to make the American point. Nor in the second. Thanks to a French revolution in the pool, France were on their way to a record haul of 7 medals.
I think the French might win this, you know. This is an amazing swim for Yannick Agnel. After so many years of coming second and third, finally the French have done it.
The French commentators to our right are going more nuts than you, Andy. I mean, they're up and down all over the place.
Les Français, champion olympique!
Nor the third. Michael Phelps was being upstaged by a South African and his dad.
What a beautiful boy. Look at him. Oh my God, look at him. Yeah, look. Sorry.
Was there to be no grand exit? There was.
The crowd starting to stand up and salute the greatest Olympian in history, Michael Phelps, bringing home the American team. The gold in the men's 4x200 metres freestyle goes to USA, and Michael Phelps becomes the greatest Olympian in history with 19 medals, his 15th gold.
We did it, so, you know, first gold medal of the meet, so I'm very happy.
The final of the men's 200 metres individual medley. Michael Phelps may well get this back, but Lochte's not giving up yet in lane four. Lochte is coming back, but I think it's going to be Phelps. The great Michael Phelps has just won his 20th Olympic medal.
Someone special rang you yesterday, didn't they?
Yeah, the president called me yesterday, and that was it was pretty cool. It was just somebody called and asked for me, and they said, hold please to the president of the United States. And I was like, okay.
Final of the men's 100 flying.
Michael Phelps in lane four, still got a lot of work to do. He is coming back, but still there is Chavich. Is Chavich going to get it? No, Phelps has got it.
Well, kids put their parents to all sorts of grief, don't they?
That is the end of Michael Phelps. And where does he finish? He finishes right on top. His 18th Olympic gold medal.
I dreamt of being the greatest, looking back at my career, and I know that I'm hanging my suit up, retiring, and looking back and saying I've done everything I've wanted.
At the age of 27, Michael Phelps was done, weighed down by 22 Olympic medals, 18 of them gold, the greatest of all time. It seemed America was hardly struggling after all. They failed to win a men's boxing medal for the first time ever, but they were going toe-to-toe with China to see who would top the overall medal table.
What about that?
The sheer ability of Lin Dan.
Three times the Olympic beach volleyball champions.
The strongest woman in the world is from China.
Gold for Merritt!
The Bryan twins in spectacular fashion.
That is what synchronized diving is all about.
Quite amazing.
Oh, Sun Yang, so good.
A ruthless display of utter brilliance.
There was one last thing on the wish list at the track, a world record to fall. Outstepped a Kenyan prodigy, a Maasai middle distance wonder. His tactics? He said, I decided to go for it.
It's all about David Rudisha,
already the world record holder, already the world champion, striding away to become the Olympic champion. How quick will it be? That's the world record! Simply unbelievable. How do you put that into words?
Team America decided to go for it the next night.
On the third leg for the USA, Bianca Knight. And she's going to hand over to Carmelita Jeddah. This looks like the USA all the way. What can Karen Stewart do? At the moment, nothing. The USA coming away. The clock is going to stop at a marvellous time. Carmelita Jeddah wins it for the USA. Jamaica in second. The Ukraine in third. It's a new world record.
America, the dominant force still in track and field, the heart of the games. There was still time for a speck of an island in the Caribbean to have the final say. The 4x100 meters relay.
Jamaica have got to get moving here. The baton changes are good. Freighter with it. And Freighter will be handing it to Blake, but Gatland's gone well, and now Tyson Gay. That's a decent change, but Blake's now right on the Americans. It's between these two. Bolt's going to have it in the lead, and you know what that means. Here he goes. They've got the baton. Bailey's trying to hold on to Bolt. He's got no chance. Bolt's away and gone. Jamaica on the gold medalist again, and it's a new world record. Smashes it to pieces. Two great teams, but only one can stand.
One small island, one small cast of actors. The giant character of the games.
It's been a really, really nice feel around London. It's just been like a party atmosphere.
It's been all buzzy and exciting.
The atmosphere is amazing. Like, everyone's just so, like, happy all the time and that.
There's so much cynicism in the press and so on, but when you actually come here and you see it on TV, it just blows you away, really, I think.
It's absolutely an amazing legacy for the whole of London and the whole of Great Britain.
There is always something of the unreal about the Olympics. All this is far removed from normal London life. Strangers talking, smiling, it's not natural. But this is the Olympic bubble. The Olympic movement began as a fantasized, noble sporting world. Without women, for privileged white men, it has had to change. But it still swears to abide by the spirit of fair play. Reality tends to crash the party, and fair play can be an early victim. Drugs, doping, somehow they always manage to find their way into the Olympic vein, and there were a handful of positive results here. The war against chemicals goes on, working out the best route to the medals. Not winning sometimes helps in a round-robin format. What happens if both teams decide not to win?
They're surfing fault after fault. They're just hitting the ball straight in the net.
Depressing. I mean, who wants to sit through something like that? It is unacceptable.
Is it wrong to enter one race when your mind is on another? Taoufik Makhloufi of Algeria in the 800 metres.
Hang on a minute.
Banned for not trying, then reinstated thanks to a doctor's note. Quick massage, feeling better, And off he went in the 1500 metres.
He's completely destroyed this Olympic field. Where on earth did he get that from?
It's a question of judgment, or judging. Here there is sometimes a problem when it's all about one person's view of things. When one boxer is knocked down six times, he might be odds on to lose.
What is the referee doing? What was wrong with that? That was a knockdown.
Should be counted.
Not here.
The winner in the blue corner.
Satoshi Shimizu of Japan only won on appeal. The referee was expelled from the games. Korean fencer Shin Lam thought she had won, only to see the clock reset to 1 second, and then to lose in that second. It led to this lonely protest.
We are going to be here for some time.
All in vain. But in general, it seemed that most were happy to be here.
Every time I see people, they all cheered up. And they keep telling us, oh, thank you, thank you. So I guess we're doing a good job.
I think the country needed this. The police had a massive leave ban. I thought if we can't get any time off in the summer, we might as well be part of the Olympics.
Oscar Pistorius of South Africa came to London, the Blade Runner. Nervous but happy was Rand Al-Mashadani of Iraq, the lowest-ranked archer who had to play Kibo Bey, the number one. It didn't last long, but it was a joy. Contrastingly, Kibo Bey went on to win the gold medal and immediately burst into tears, apologising to her country for winning with an eight. In Korea, she said, "We do not shoot eights." Sport is taken seriously in Korea, and they had a seriously good games, especially when they had a weapon in their hands. Iran were very good at lifting heavy things and people.
The world keeps spinning, changing the lives of people in it. Nobody knows where it will take us, but I hope it gets better, better, better.
Pavlos Kontidis won a first ever medal for Cyprus, a silver in the sailing. And 15-year-old Ruta Milutita won Lithuania's first gold medal in the swimming. Perhaps it wasn't so much these individual feats that stood out as much as those of a whole section of competitors, of one gender. These were the Olympics of the women. London in the age of the suffragettes had done its bit, a little bit, to allow women into the Olympics. There was women's tennis and archery in 1908. But in 2012, women came from everywhere to compete at the Games, for the first time from Qatar and Saudi Arabia. For the first time, there was women's boxing.
And the Olympic champion in the red corner, representing Ireland, Katie Tyler!
Women provided the finish of the Games.
They're shoulder to shoulder. Norton comes alongside. Norton of Sweden takes the lead away from Spirit. Oh, it's a photo finish in the Olympic triathlon.
Women took their spills and probably cried less than the men. It couldn't be perfect for everyone, although Holly Bleasdale's Olympics ended not with a flop, but a proposal of marriage. She said yes. But no, it couldn't end happily for everyone. And for one Londoner, it turned into a difficult time from start to finish. Philip Sidowu, born in Hackney, just a hop, skip and jump away from the stadium on a good day. He arrived at last, but for him there was no home advantage.
He will not make it through to the final.
But what of London? How were the games for the city? A question only a Londoner can answer.
Us Londoners are a funny lot. Used to living life at pace, and whatever happens in the city, we find a way to deal with it. Now, before the games began, there was a tangible sense of apprehension. We knew the world would be watching, and we wanted to get it right. We're also a pretty honest bunch. We don't pretend things are perfect when they're not. You see, getting around the city has not been the easiest, with the Olympic lanes causing havoc on London's roads.
Everyday life for those working and living around the Games has undoubtedly been unsettled. And there's probably a significant number of people looking forward to getting their city back.
But the vast majority have embraced the Olympics. I mean, let's face it, it's not going to be back again in most people's lifetimes. That is why there has been so much frustration at empty seats.
Millions applied for tickets and didn't get them. They would have loved to have witnessed those incredible Where Were You moments firsthand.
Please don't run away with the idea that this is a public response to these venues. It's not. I mean, those venues are humming and they're full.
The vibe is just amazing. Everyone's really happy. Even though you support different countries, everyone's just really friendly. The atmosphere is amazing.
The popularity of free events said it all. Thousands lining the rainy streets of central London for the women's marathon, and Bradley Wiggins and the boys being cheered on for all 250 kilometres of the road race cycling.
What an incredible experience to be riding on the roads of London surrounded by hundreds of thousands of British fans.
Londoners aren't known for being particularly sociable, but if you're in any doubt that the Olympics were special, you won't be now. You see, we've huddled around screens, waved flags, and best of all, we've done it together.
Londoners are arguably at their strongest during the bad times. A stubborn resilience born out of necessity more than anything else. Maybe that's why we're often seen as cold and antisocial even.
But the last 2.5 weeks have proven that we can enjoy ourselves. The atmosphere in the stadiums has filtered out onto the streets and the city is buzzing. You can feel it in the air. And there's only one thing that everyone's talking about.
Jess Curtis. She's awesome.
The cycling guy, Sir Chris Hoy.
Bradley Wiggins.
Luke Campbell, who's from Hull, which is where we're from.
Mo Farah and Jess Ennis.
We just cheered and cheered and cheered.
I think it's the old British thing, isn't it? When there's something like this, we all come together and we all rejoice in something that is so wonderful.
When the Games have gone, London will return to life as normal. Olympic lanes will disappear. Venues will be pulled down. Lords will host cricket, not archery. Pageantry and tradition will return to Horse Guards Parade. The big city will never quite be the same, but we'll always have the memories. 16 days of amazing smiles and sport. One or two of those. Huh?
There's something of a chill that comes with that, going back to normal. Are even those who soared at London 2012 going to come down with a bump? Are we soon to go back to taking the details of things going wrong and magnifying them? Remember the seats that went empty? The days that passed without a gold medal.
Beautiful! The place erupts!
We still have the question of legacy, and the question is a tough one. How do you follow this? What comes next? In a way, though, this nation in debt, our land of doubters, had already set a new tone.
The Olympic flame burns on British soil at last.
Back in the days when the Games were on their way to London and there was still time to be a bit sceptical about the whole thing, the torch pulled people out of their homes, up and down, and all the way across the country.
Hey, look at these crowds, come on!
Congratulations!
Thank you!
I'm not really anybody and people are stood there cheering me on and I just think that's ridiculous.
I felt like I was in Wonderland.
This was what people thought of the games, and it simply went on from there.
I hope I've managed to do it, that's all. I don't want to let anybody down, you know.
You got two choices in life: sit and be lazy and do nothing and depressed, or get up, get your legs on, and live your life exactly the same way you did before.
And it turned into this. 2 weeks that changed the way we looked at sport and each other. Could we afford it? Probably not. Was it worth it? The people who came out and made the games, these London Games of 2012, have already answered that question. Inspire a generation. The billboard slogan that became the Olympic wish that came true.
I hope someday you will join us.